Good morning, Lifehouse. Ask you to stand with us this morning as we start to worship. Before we start singing this morning, just want to remind us why we do this whole thing. I know it can be tradition and just ritual and habit for us to sing in the morning, but it's a lot more important than that. The words that we sing here in all these songs, whether it's hymns or it's modern music, they're all to help us focus on who Jesus is and what he's done for us. It's very easy to be distracted this morning. I'm sure there's a million things that all of us are thinking about. I know I have lots of things to think about outside of this morning. But I just want to encourage us that reading these words and singing these words to one another and praising God is what helps us focus on him. And as we study through the book of Hebrews, we're constantly saying what? Look to Jesus, right? So this morning, if you came in distracted, you came in worried or anxious or in trouble, just focus on the words and let them wash over you. We're here to worship this morning. If you came in feeling not ready and excited to worship, worship your way into worshiping. Sing your way into singing. Pray your way into praying.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow turning with thee. Thou changest not thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness. Great is the
Good morning, everyone. Just to introduce, there's a lot of folks in the room tonight. For those I don't know, my name's Matt Grabowski. This is my wife, Jacqueline. We're members here at Lifehouse Smyrna. If you've seen our kids running around, we have four. We have Kate, Ian, Jack, and Eliana. And we're going to lead the prayer portion of today's service. Praying for gospel-centered service. Each week, we are praying and fasting through our mission to help people follow Jesus here at Lifehouse. We believe that we do this by focusing on four things, core values, so to speak, which include gospel-centered worship, gospel-centered community, gospel-centered service, and gospel-centered multiplication. And this being the third week in February, is gospel-centered service. We have three points and scriptures we want to pray through. I'm praying that we would be a body that sacrificially serves the needs within the church, and pray for the deacon teams to expand and add Sunday team leaders for the serving teams, and pray for weekly opportunities to serve our community and share the gospel. So I have the first one. I'll hand it off to you after that. excuse me. So again, we're praying that we would be the body that sacrificially serves the needs of the church. And for our scripture, with that point, I have Romans 12:1, which says, "I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship." Let us pray. Lord, we pray that we surrender to your will and give you everything, all of our time, all of our finances, all of our plans, Lord, everything we give to you, even our very lives, if that would be your will for us, Lord. We know that faith without works or service is a dead faith, as it says in the book of James, Lord. And we know that it's not works that save us, Lord, that only you, and that you have the power to save us. And we pray that our works show evidence for the work that you are doing in our lives, Lord. We know that work and service is hard, Lord. Labor is hard. But, Lord, I pray that you strengthen and build up those of us in the room today, those online at home, Lord, that they will be able to sustain and continue serving the needs of this church, Lord, the church that you've placed in this community of Smyrna. Amen.
Point two is to pray for the deacon team. To expand and add Sunday team leaders for serving teams. Philippians 2:3-5 says, "Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus." And we're going to pray. Father, we pray that you would continue to build your church, not us, because we will get it wrong. We ask that you would raise up more leaders, elders, deacons, life group leaders, ministry leaders, and serving teams, God. Remind us this is your work, not ours. We thank you, Lord, for all that you have done. You continue to carry us through COVID, providing us a space to worship in each week. You send volunteers for setup and teardown, music worship and slides, children and youth. Lord, thank you for all that you've done and continue to do. But if we are so bold, Lord, we ask for more. Amen. And our third point is to pray for weekly opportunities to serve our community and share the gospel. Mark 16:15 says, "And he said to them, go into all this world and proclaim the gospel to the whole creation." Let's pray. We pray for our local community in the town of Smyrna. We pray for our families, neighbors, and our workplaces. We pray that our congregation be filled with the Holy Spirit and that we not share the gospel just out of habit or requirement, but as an overflow of your love and grace that we can't keep to ourselves. It must be shared. This world is broken and in desperate need of you, Lord. Amen.
Would you guys stand and worship with us?
give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we
gift for this time that we're here together. Lord, in your word, it says that we will tell of your name to our brothers and our sisters. In the midst of the congregation, we will sing your praise. And again, Lord, we put our trust in you. So I pray this morning, Lord, that as we sang together, we rehearse these truths to hearts that were believing and also hearts that are doubting, hearts that are unsure, maybe even hearts that are unbelieving. Lord, I pray that the rehearsal of these truths of you did just that and built our faith. Lord, that your spirit used them to grow us into dependence on you, in your beauty, your faithfulness. Lord, you are great. You are greatly to be praised. Father, you are the lion and the lamb. Thank you, Lord. What a kind king you are. In your name, amen.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Lifehouse Church Smyrna. My name is Barbie Wilson, and I'm a member here. We're so glad you've joined us for worship this morning. Here's what's coming up. If you are a first-time guest with us, we are so glad you've joined us for worship this morning. Please scan the QR code on the screen and fill out the online Connect card. Then visit the welcome table after the service. We have a special gift for you and your family to say thank you for joining us this morning. We believe that generosity is not something that God wants from us, it's something God wants for us. Giving is a way that we respond in worship. Every time that we give, we support our mission to help more people follow Jesus. You can give in person in the back of the room, online at lifehousesmyrna.com, or text a dollar amount to 84321. Today, following the service, we will have an important training meeting for anyone who is interested in or currently serving in our Lifehouse Kids Ministries for children ages babies through fifth grade. Men, you are invited to the men's breakfast on February 26th at 7 a.m. Please bring a friend and a dish to share. We are so excited for the upcoming women's retreat on March 18th and 19th. Ladies, you can sign up today through the Church Center app or on our website. The last day to sign up is March 6th. Don't miss out on this opportunity to grow in your relationship with Jesus. This summer, we are so excited to send a team to Ashland, Kentucky to partner with the local churches to help serve and reach the community with the gospel. Please join us in the fellowship hall after the service on March 6th for more info. If you would like to learn more about these events and others, you can download the Church Center app, check out our Facebook page, or visit lifehousesmyrna.com. Now, join us as we dive into the next part of our current sermon series, Look to Jesus, through the book of Hebrews.
All right, good morning. I would like to dismiss the 4 and 5-year-olds. If you guys can head back, Miss Melanie's in the back waving her hand. So if you're 4 or 5 and would like to go out with the kids and have your own special time, you can go ahead and head out there. While they're exiting, if you're remaining in here, so if you're still seated, I'm assuming that's what you're going to do, we're going to be in Hebrews chapter 4. So if you want to use your Bible, brought your Bible, please open there. If you don't have your Bibles with you, the passage will be on the screens behind me as well. The other thing I want to mention, because it is a big part of what we're doing today we have a baptism after the service, so we're super, super excited. Yeah, amen. That we have 5 people that have decided to take that next step of faith, that step of obedience to be baptized, right? We say in the Great Commission every week at the end of the service, go and make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So we're excited that 5 individuals are going to do that today. And what that's going to look like is after the message, we're going to have them come up. We're going to introduce them. They're going to share, have a time of sharing, and then we're going to go outside. Praise God that the wind has died down, and we're going to have baptism out in the building in the third bay. So we would ask you guys to, we'll prompt you, of course, but we're going to be heading outside, and the water's warm. We're not trying to freeze anybody out, so we have warm water. But anyway, we're going to jump into Hebrews 4 right away. And before we dive into the word, will you guys join me in a word of prayer, because we're going to ask God's Spirit to enlighten us and help us understand what we're going to be reading today. So let's pray. Father, we come before you this morning acknowledging that you are God, acknowledging that we are not, acknowledging that we are in desperate need of you, acknowledging, Lord, that apart from you, we are foolish and we are helpless. But God, thank you for your Spirit that you give us, God, not only to initiate that new birth, God, but you fill us with your Spirit so we can understand your truth, as your word says. God, we're asking, as you tell us to in James, for wisdom. We need your wisdom. So God, we just pray that you would give us understanding as we read this passage. And not only understanding, we don't want to just be hearers of this word. We want to be doers of this word. So God, we pray that you would help us to obey what we hear today. God, we pray that you would give us the faith to respond. And God, we pray at the end of the day that you would be glorified. And we ask all this in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. All right, let's pick up in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 1. The author writes, "Therefore, while the promise of entering his rest still stands, let us fear lest any of you should seem to have failed to reach it. For good news came to us, just as to them, but the message they heard did not benefit them, because they were not united by faith with those who listened. For we who have believed enter that rest. As he has said, as I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest. Although his works were finished from the foundation of the world, for he has somewhere spoken of the seventh day in this way, and God rested on the seventh day from all his works. And again, in this passage, he said, they shall not enter my rest. Since therefore it remains for some to enter it, and those who formerly received the good news failed to enter because of disobedience, again he appoints a certain day, today, saying through David so long afterward, in the words already quoted, today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. For if Joshua had given them rest, God would not have spoken of another day later on. So then, there remains a Sabbath rest for the people of God. For whoever has entered God's rest has also rested from his works as God did from his. Let us therefore strive to enter that rest so that no one may fall by the same sort of disobedience. For the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and of spirit, of joints and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. Verse 13, and no creature is hidden from his sight, but all are naked and exposed to the eyes of him to whom we must give account. Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Now, whenever we approach God's word, I think, you know, we got to remind ourselves, especially the person that's going to be delivering that word, is we got to let God's word speak, right? That's what we're here today. We want to hear from God, not from man, right? And sometimes it takes a little bit more work, I would say, to draw out maybe what the main theme or what God's speaking here, but in this passage, it's pretty easy. In Hebrews 4, the word rest is mentioned 10 times. I don't know if you picked up on that. So that's obviously a main theme in this passage. And then the other word that is mentioned just almost as much is the word enter. And that word enter is mentioned 7 times. So how is God speaking to us? What is he trying to drive home today as we read Hebrews 4? So what do you think we're going to be talking about? Rest, entering this rest. So again, in the broader context of Hebrews, we've been talking about this church that is struggling. They are suffering, right? They are going through such a hard time. Many of them are tempted to go back to Judaism. They're tempted to walk away from the church. They're tempted to walk away from the faith. They're suffering. And they're experiencing anything but rest. They are restless. You guys ever been there? You ever been restless? That's where we find this church. And what does the author do? He's encouraging them that although they are restless in a state of restlessness right now because of everything that's happening around them, he's encouraging them that they can find rest in Jesus Christ. Doesn't matter what's going on. You can have rest. That's what the author encourages them with. You can have rest. So here's our main idea today in the context, the broader context of looking to Jesus. When we look to Jesus, when you look to Jesus, when I look to Jesus, we find our rest. It's that simple. When we look to Jesus, you and I will find our rest. So what I want to do today is just ask some very simple questions that hopefully will lead us to a greater understanding of what God is saying to us here. The first question is this: what is rest? According to what this is talking about, right? What is this rest? Now, maybe when we typically think about rest, we're thinking about our beds, right? We're thinking about the couch. We're thinking about a vacation. We're thinking about maybe some of us, maybe you get some medication to help you with rest, right? All kinds of sleeping aids out there. Maybe a special pillow, maybe a special blanket. Maybe it's outdoors, right? You have your place where you just try to go and find rest. But based on the condition of this church, This is not the kind of rest that the author has in view, right? This author, right, this pastoral figure could not offer this church that kind of rest. He could not promise that their suffering would go away. He could not promise that things would get better. He could not promise that. But what he could promise them with is they could find rest in the midst of their suffering. So what kind of rest is he talking about? The kind of rest that he has in view here is a spiritual rest, right? The kind of that inner rest. And that's the kind of rest that we can have no matter what's going around us. When things seem to be falling apart, when life seems to be falling apart, you guys know it if you've experienced it, you can have that inner rest. And that's what he has in view here. And this is the same kind of rest that Jesus had in view in Matthew 11, 28 and 29. You guys are familiar with this verse. Jesus said, come to me, when he's talking to his disciples, when he walked this earth, he said, come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, I will give you rest. Well, what kind of rest? Take my yoke upon you, he says, and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and here it is, you will find rest for your souls. That's the kind of rest that we're talking about, that soul rest, that inner rest, which is another way of saying salvation. We need rest for our souls, right? Because of our sin, we are separated from God. And the Bible tells us that what awaits us is God's wrath and judgment. And I don't know about you, with knowing that I don't find much peace or rest in that, right? But God provides us rest. God provides us rest, a soul rest. So here's the remedy, right? This church is restless. Maybe you walked in here today and you are experiencing restlessness. So what is the remedy to restlessness? It's not more sleep. It's not a vacation, right? You guys have been on vacations and you come back and it doesn't solve your inner struggle. It doesn't give you the peace that you so long for. We try to look for it all other places, but you've been there. You know it, right? I'm preaching to the choir right now. We know what it's like to strive for this rest in all other places, but we never experience it. But I also know that you have also, many of you have also experienced that even though you're tired, even though you're weary, even though you're struggling, that you still have this inner peace, this inner rest that Jesus is talking about, this soul rest. Now, kind of breaking this down a little bit, the original Greek translated rest communicates a place or a state of rest. A place or a state of rest. So let's think about salvation in those terms. So this salvation rest can be understood as a place, right? In the sense of Colossians chapter 1, verses 13 through 14, where Paul so famously said, he, Christ, has delivered us from the domain of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption and forgiveness of sins. So we see it in the context of a place. Like we who were once in the kingdom of darkness have now been transferred to the kingdom of his beloved Son. And there's an already and not yet aspect to this place of our rest, right? So we are in God's kingdom now, but it's not completely fulfilled until God's consummated kingdom when Christ returns, right? And we will talk about that in a moment. But that's how we can understand rest as a place. And in this passage, the author illustrates salvation as a place of rest by referring to the Old Testament or using the Old Testament picture of the promised land, right? The Israelites had a place that they were headed to that God promised that was going to be their rest. And we see this in Genesis chapter 17, right? This was God's people have always been associated with a place. Genesis 17, 8. God said, and I will give to you and to your offspring, talking to Abraham, after you, the land of your sojournings, all the land of Canaan, for an everlasting possession, and I will be their God. Why is this place so significant? Because God's in this place. So that's what they were looking forward to, right? They were the Israelites, they were rescued from Egypt, right? They're out in the wilderness. They're headed somewhere, right? God does not just save us from something, he saves us to something. But here's the deal. In verse 8, we see that this promised land was not the final fulfillment of God's rest. Because he says, if that were the case, if Joshua, who led that second generation of Israelites, what happened to the first generation of Israelites? That Exodus. They died in the wilderness. They did not get to enter the promised land. But Joshua came along and he was able to successfully guide the Israelites into the promised land. But that was not it. That's what verse 9 tells us. That was not it, because there was a greater rest yet to come. But it was going to be patterned after the promised land. And we see this in Revelation chapter 21, verses 1 through 4. This is what we are in God's kingdom now, but this is where we are headed. This is what we get to look forward to. John writes, "Then I saw a new heaven and new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man.'" Very similar to the promise that God gave Abraham, right? And he continues by saying, "He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God." And verse 4, I don't know how anybody in this room could not be encouraged by this. "He will wipe away every tear from their eyes." I mean, you guys know what tears are like, right? You guys have experienced tears. There will be a place that there will be no more tears. And then he goes on to say, "And death shall be no more." You guys have experienced death, right? As you know somebody, you've experienced a loved one dying. This place that we are headed to, there will be no more death. There'll be no more mourning. There'll be no crying nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. Can you imagine what that would be like? You want to talk about rest? But this is just like the Israelites were headed to the promised land. We are headed. This is where we're headed. So it's an already and not yet. And the author compares the Christian life to the Exodus wandering of Israel in the wilderness. And as Christians, following the greater Joshua, right? Following the greater Joshua, Jesus Christ, we're following him to a greater promised land, which we're going to see later in Hebrews, described in multiple facets. This is, I'll go through them very quickly, but in Hebrews 11:14, the author describes this promised land that we are hoping in, the city that has foundations. In chapter 11, verse 16, a better country, that is a heavenly one. In chapter 12, verse 22, the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem. Chapter 12, verse 28, a kingdom that cannot be shaken. And then in chapter 13, verse 14, the city that is yet to come. Isn't that amazing? This is what we get to look forward to. So this is again, we're describing the salvation rest as a place. That's how we can describe it, as a place. But according to our definition, salvation rest is also to be understood as a state, which kind of gives us the already aspect of our salvation rest, right? So we're looking forward to this place. We're not there yet, but we will be. But the state is something that we can experience now, this state of rest. And it's a state of rest patterned after, Hebrews tells us, creation, where on the seventh day, God rested from his works. And this is what the author says in Hebrews chapter 4, verses 3 through 4, talking about God. "His works were finished from the foundation of the world, for he has somewhere spoken to the seventh day in this way, and God rested on the seventh day from all his works." So God established the pattern in creation, and then jump ahead to verse 10 in chapter 4, we follow that pattern. "For whoever has entered God's rest has also rested from his works as God did from his. See, that's the state of rest, that we rest from our works. And what we need to understand, this is not resting from work. This is not what the author of Hebrews is saying. We're not resting from work. We're resting in God's completed work. That's a whole different scenario, right? We're not resting from work, but we are resting in. This is the state of our salvation rest. We are resting in God's completed work. This goes all the way back to Hebrews chapter 1:3 when we first opened up this series, right? We looked at that beautiful picture that Jesus ascended to the throne room of heaven, and we read, after making purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. Like, Jesus rested because the work was completed. And what we need to understand is that salvation is the state of resting from the exhausting and the futile work of trying to earn our way to heaven, because Jesus did the work for us by living the life that we could not live and going to the cross and dying the death that we deserved. And then he rose again, conquering sin, death, and hell. This is why Jesus said in John 19:30, it is finished. He didn't say, I've partially finished it. Right? He didn't say, I've done 90% of it. You need to do the other 10%. He said, it is finished. Like, I've done it. So the follower of Christ enjoys this rest, this state of rest, resting from our works here and now. That's what it means to be a Christian. I'm not working to earn God's love. I'm resting in God's love in and through Jesus Christ. And my work is not to earn salvation. My work is in light of my salvation. Now, so we've talked about the idea that we can understand salvation rest as a place, as a state. But I want to add one other element that was kind of left off our definition. Salvation rests can ultimately be understood as a person. Because God completed the work required for salvation, the author makes sure in verse 1 to highlight his rest. His rest. He says, therefore, while the promise of entering his rest still stands. And to reinforce this idea, he quotes Psalm 95:11 twice, in verse 3 and verse 5, where God declares that it's my rest. It's my rest. And this is what Augustine said in light of that. He said, God, you have made us for yourself, and our hearts are restless till they find their rest in you. You guys get that? We will be restless until we find rest in him. So if you're in here today, whether you've professed faith in Christ for 30, 40 years, or you've never made that profession of faith in Christ, I want to tell you something. There is no rest outside of God. There is no rest. Maybe you're in here and you're still trying, you're searching for this rest. And you've been searching and you've been looking in all these places and it seems to elude you. It's because you will not find this rest that you're looking for until you look to Jesus. And this is, again, we just looked at it, Matthew 11:28. Jesus said, come to me. Where are we going to find rest? By coming to him. He said, come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden. Anybody laboring? Anybody heavy laden in here? If we go to Jesus, he says, I will give you rest. It's his rest. It has to be given. So going back to our original question, what is rest? This is what I want to kind of end this, that question with. I want each and every person in this room to know without a shadow of a doubt that God has made rest available for you today. Each and every person, it is available. God's rest is available to you today. Now let's ask the next question. Well, how do we enter this rest? We know it's available. We kind of understand what it is now, hopefully. So how do we enter God's rest? Now, the first thing I want to point out from the back half of verse 1 is that the author gives a very clear warning here. The idea of warnings are not new to us as we've been walking through Hebrews, right? There's lots of warning. But he makes it very clear that not everyone will enter this rest. Not everyone will. And this warning becomes even more serious when we realize this warning was given to a church. Right? This isn't like the non-believing, the pagan world. Like, this warning was given to the church. Not everybody will enter this rest. That should perk up our ears, right? The very reminiscent of Matthew 7:21. Again, this coming from Jesus himself. He said, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord. Who says, Lord, Lord? Church people. Not everybody who says to me, Lord, Lord, will, here it is, the idea, will enter the kingdom of heaven, right? That we talked about, that idea of place. But the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. And this is why the author says, let us fear. Let us fear the fact that not everybody will enter this rest. And by saying us, the author's including himself, I find that fascinating. Let us fear. And this indicates that this warning is for every Christian, not just weak Christians, not just baby Christians, every Christian. It doesn't matter how strong we think we are, right? We are all at risk of failing to enter God's rest. How many stories do we have to hear, right? Of people walking away from the faith, pastors walking away from the faith, right? We can never get to the point where we're like, we've got this, right? I've arrived. I've got this. I would never fall away. Because we get to that point, we are operating in pride. And God gives grace to the humble, but he opposes the proud. Now, when we understand this idea of fear, this is not a debilitating fear. This is not a fear that makes us retreat. This is a fear that that calls us or compels us to some type of action, right? It's kind of like, be alert, be on guard. Now, what is this action that the author is trying to stimulate this church towards? Well, he tells us in verse 2 and 3, for good news came to us, justice to them, but the message they heard did not benefit them. Can you imagine that? They heard the message, but it didn't benefit them. But because they were not united by faith with those who listened. And then here it is in verse 3. For we who have believed enter that rest. So we enter God's rest. That's the answer to our question. We enter God's rest by faith. That's it, by faith. And that's consistent with what Paul says in Ephesians 2:8 and 9. You guys know this verse. For by grace we have been saved by what? Through faith. And this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God. And just in case we think we can work or earn it, not a result of works. It's not a result of works. We've got to rest from our work. It's not a result from works, so that no one may boast. And man, I'm so thankful for Hebrews 4 because of all the confusion in the church about faith. Like, what it means to believe. What is faith? What is saving faith? And what I like about Hebrews 4 is he actually gives us a picture, right? We do well when we can have pictures, when we can see what this looks like. And in verse 2 and 4, the author once again uses the example of the Exodus generation of the Israelites who made it out of Egypt. Remember that, right? They were led out of Egypt. They made it through the Red Sea. They're in the wilderness. The promised land is before them. But they failed to reach the promised land. And their issue, please hear this. Their issue was not that they did not believe in God. They believed in God, right? They saw God work in miraculous ways, right? This generation saw God pour out the 10 plagues on Egypt. They saw God's power. They saw God part the Red Sea, right? They saw God on the other side of the wilderness appearing to them as a pillar of cloud by day and fire by night. Like, they knew God existed, but why did they fall short? Because they did not trust God. We're told that they failed to trust in the good news that God provided them a land for them to rest in. God says, here, I've got this land for you. I'm leading you to this land, but they did not trust that message. That's the good news that the writer of Hebrews is talking about. They received the promise of a land, of a promised land. They heard it. They have seen God work, but they failed to trust. Now, how do we know they did not trust God's promise? They did not obey him. Trust, please hear this, is demonstrated through our obedience, right? If we trust God, we will obey him. In this Exodus generation, even though they heard the good news, what does the author tell us? It did not benefit them. Why did it not benefit them? Because they died in the wilderness. It didn't benefit them in the sense that it did not lead them into God's salvation rest, right? Again, we got to, yes, it's a land, but it's a picture of salvation. In the same way, the author is reminding the church that good news has come to them, that through the person and work of Jesus Christ, God has made a way for them to enter God's salvation rest. But what he's saying is that it will not benefit them if they refuse to trust in this message, right? He's warning them. They heard the good news. It did not benefit them. Please don't let it happen to you that you would know this gospel message and it would not benefit you. And we're warned today that hearing and intellectually agreeing with the facts of the gospel does not guarantee you and I that we will enter his rest. This is James 2:19 is a great reminder of this. You believe that God is one. Just like the Israelites, you believe there's a God. You do well. But then he goes on to say, even the demons believe and shudder. He's saying just believing in the existence of a God is not enough. Demons believe in God, but they don't trust God. So this kind of trusting faith called for by Hebrews is illustrated by the two men from the Exodus generation who were allowed to enter the promised land. Does anybody know who they are? Joshua and Caleb, right? And again, I love pictures, and I think we do well when we can picture this. Numbers chapter 14, verse 2 through 3, we get a great picture of what this unbelief looks like and what faith looks like. So Numbers chapter 14, verse 2 through 3, this is a picture of unbelief. Remember, they believed in God, but they didn't trust God. And all the people of Israel grumbled against Moses and Aaron. The whole congregation said to them, would that we had died in the land of Egypt, or would that we had died in this wilderness. Why is the Lord bringing us into this land to fall by the sword? Our wives and our little ones will become a prey. Would it not be better for us to go back to Egypt? That's what unbelief looks like. Like they've seen God work and they don't trust him that he's going to lead them safely into the promised land. And now they're saying, I want to go back. Slavery in Egypt was better. They failed to trust in God's promise. Then let's look at Joshua and Caleb. Let's see what trust looks like. And Joshua, the son of Nun, and Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, who were among those who had spied out the land, tore their clothes and said to all the congregation of the people of Israel, the land which we passed through to spy it out is an exceedingly good land. Like, we like what we see. If the Lord delights in us, he will bring us into this land and give it to us. We trust God. If God says we're going to have it, he's going to give it to us. A land that flows with milk and honey. See, they trusted God, but the rest of the generation did not. They stopped short of entering God's rest. Joshua and Caleb entered. Now, the warning today is that we must move beyond an intellectual agreement with the gospel to actually trusting the gospel. There are so many people, I'm convinced, within the church that just, they will agree to the gospel. Yeah, I believe that Jesus died or lived, died, and rose again. I believe in those facts, but they don't trust in it, right? They believe in a set of facts, but they're not trusting in the gospel, and they don't have rest. Now, how do we know if we've trusted in this message, if this message is going to benefit us? Well, going back to verse 10, we rest from trying to work for our salvation. How many of us get caught up into that? I've got to do more. I've got to read my Bible. I've got to go to church. And if I do all these things, maybe God will love me. We rest from trying to prove our own righteousness.
We acknowledge that we're sinners, right? This is how this starts. I'm a sinner. I'm helpless. I'm hopeless. I can't be good enough or try hard enough. I acknowledge that. But I also acknowledge my desperate need for a Savior. And I believe that Jesus lived and died and rose for me. And I believe and I trust if I place my faith in him that I am cleansed, that I am forgiven, and that I'm made new just as he promised. And I don't have to work to earn God's love anymore. I rest in God's love. And when I mess up, and when I fail, I don't have to say, oh man, God doesn't love me anymore. No, I get back up and I keep trusting in the gospel. I keep trusting in 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. I trust that. Do you trust that? Here's the deal. If you're still banking on your own merit for your salvation, if you think that you can be good enough or you can try hard enough, what the Hebrews 4 tells us is you're walking in unbelief. And if you're walking in unbelief, you will be prevented from entering God's rest. So as we kind of leave this second question, I want each and every person in this room today to know without a shadow of a doubt that you can enter God's rest today. How? By placing your faith and trust in Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. That's it. Rest is available, and we can enter that rest by placing our faith and trust in Jesus Christ. Lastly, I want to ask the third question, which we see in this passage, is how do we persevere in God's rest? It's important, right? This whole, the whole book of Hebrews is this call to endurance, this call to perseverance. And we see this in verse 11. He says, let us therefore, knowing that it's possible that some will not enter this rest, because that is a truth, because that is a reality, let us therefore strive to enter that rest so that no one may fall by the same sort of disobedience. Now, strive communicates the idea that we must make every effort to continue to trust. And what we need to understand today, the church needs to understand today that trusting in Jesus is not a one-time thing. Right? It's not something that I raise my hand and yeah, I trusted Jesus, or maybe I walk down an aisle and I say, I trusted in Jesus. It's not I trust Jesus into salvation, then I go back to trusting myself for life. Right? Trusting Jesus is a lifelong process. It is from the moment we trust initially unto salvation to the moment we either die from this world or Jesus returns. Right, we keep trusting, we keep trusting, we keep trusting. That's how we persevere in our faith. And this shows us that our faith, an aspect of our faith must be diligent. It must be trusting, but it also must be diligent. And we see this idea in Philippians chapter 2, verse 12 through 13, where Paul writes, therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, so now, not only as in my presence, but much more in my absence, Paul says, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Like there's work involved. So again, this goes back to the idea, it's not ceasing from work, it's resting in God's finished work, and then it's working out our salvation with fear and trembling. I'm not working to earn anything from God, but I'm working to grow and to mature in my faith. And then he goes on to say, for it's God who works in you both to will and to work for his good pleasure. So this is wonderful dichotomy, right? So God does the work in us. We trust Philippians 1:6 that God who started the good work in us will be faithful to complete it. We trust that. We rest in that. But we also work at our salvation with fear and trembling. We cooperate with God's work. Now it's important to keep in mind that this warning against failing to reach God's rest, and this is why we got this call for perseverance, it was given to a church filled with professing Christians. These people, most likely, of course, they had made a profession of faith. That's why they were in the church. They had been baptized. They had been partaking in the Lord's Supper. They were involved in the life of the church. And here's this warning, man, fear this in case lest you fall short of entering God's rest. What we need to understand, there's a difference between a primary experience of rest, right? Or a primary experience, like, I'm going to do this, I'm going to place my faith and trust in Jesus Christ, compared to a life of living in this rest. It's easy to trust Jesus when things are good, but it's a lot harder, it's a lot more difficult to trust in Jesus when things are difficult. And this is where faith comes in, right? This is what was happening to this church. Things were going good, I'm sure. They left Judaism. They became followers of Christ. Here they are following Christ. There's this church formed. Things are going good. And then all of a sudden, here comes all this craziness, persecution that we've been talking about. They're like, wait a second. What happened to all that we had? And now we're experiencing this. And I tell you what, Judaism is looking a lot better right now. I'm thinking about going back. As Mike said last week, this stuck with me. I hope it stuck with you. A strong start in the Christian life does not guarantee a strong finish. The most important thing about us now is how we respond to the gospel today. How are you responding to the gospel today? Not yesterday, not last week, not a year ago, not maybe when you were at a youth camp, not maybe one day when you did VBS. I'm talking about today. How are you responding to the gospel today? That's the most important thing about our Christian lives. Here's the question. Are we still looking to Jesus? Are we still trusting Jesus just as much as the day we first believed? Instead of looking back in unbelief, the author calls his audience to persevere in their faith by continuing to look to Jesus. So let's talk about perseverance for a second. How do we persevere in the Christian faith? He gives us two of the major ways we do that at the end of this passage. First is we persevere through his word. As Christians, we have to stay in God's word. He says in verse 12, why? Because for the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and spirit, of joints and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And no creature is hidden from his sight, but all are naked and exposed to the eyes of him to whom we must give account. See, God's word diagnoses our spiritual health, right? When we're not reading God's word, it's easy to hide. It's easy to pretend. But when you read God's word and you're confronted with the truth, you're like, am I believing? Am I trusting? The Bible says, don't fear. Why am I fearing? Right? The Bible says, right, don't be anxious about anything, but pray about everything. Then why am I being anxious? So when you read God's word, it confronts you. Am I going to trust this? Am I going to rest in this? Please understand this. We will not persevere apart from God's word. Because when you walk away from God's word, right, that's when that slow drift starts to happen. And you stop believing, you stop trusting. That's why we need God's word. Not to be cliche, but you have to read God's word. Man shall not live on bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. Like, this should not be the only time that you're hearing God's word, right? It's daily. It's in meditating on it, storing it up in our heart that we might not sin against God. Like, we live by God's word. Jesus said in John 8:31 that my disciples will abide in my word. Are you abiding in God's word? And then the second way we persevere is through prayer. Nothing new under the sun, right? The word and prayer. Nothing exciting here, right? The word in prayer, no gimmicks, no secret sauce. It's just the word in prayer. Verse 14, since then we have a great high priest who has passed through heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness. Do you guys get that? Like, we're weak. You're weak. I'm weak. If we're going to try to do this in our own strength or on our own, we will not last. We will not persevere. But we have a high priest who can sympathize with our weakness because he became a man. As Hebrews tells us, he became like us in every way. He knows what it's like to live in this flesh. But one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. There it is. He, right? That's 2 Corinthians 5:21. God made him who knew no sin to be sin on our behalf so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. So because of that, because we can stand before God righteous in his sight, because Jesus, because of Christ's righteousness, because of that, verse 16, let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in a time of need. The central strategy of the enemy, you guys have experienced this, is to make it seem like God is distant. Is to make it seem like God is unapproachable. You guys ever been there? Oh man, I sinned, right? That's like Adam and Eve, like they're hiding from God. But no, like because, right, we're not righteous in and of ourselves. We are righteous in Christ. And because of that, we are righteous and we can go confident before the throne of God. Not in our own righteousness, but in the righteousness of Christ. And we can approach him with confidence. And here's the deal. When we are struggling, when we are weak, what do we need most? God. But we need his grace and we need his mercy. Isn't that the Christian life? God's grace and God's mercy. What do you need more of today? I need more of God's grace and got more of God's mercy. And where do we find that? By going to him. So again, we need to approach him all the while recognizing that we have a faithful high priest who sympathizes with our weakness. And he's not saying, stay away. He's not saying, you're not good enough. He's saying, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. So you see this idea that God wants us to come to him, right? He's approachable, he's close, he's near. But we must go to him. So again, let me say this. We will not persevere apart from prayer. The word and prayer, that's how we keep trusting. That's how we keep looking. That's how we keep following Jesus. So let me finish this last question with this. I want each and every person in this room to know without a shadow of a doubt that if you can rest in Jesus for your salvation, you can rest in Jesus for the entirety of your life. Right? If you're going to trust him to save you, do not think you can trust him for all areas of your life. Think about that for a second. If I'm going to put my trust in him that because of his life, death, and resurrection, my sins can be forgiven, and I'm not going to trust him over here to provide for me, think about that for a second. Like we're called to trust him with the entirety of our lives. So in closing, again, let's think about this picture. What the author of Hebrews is doing is he's giving the Christian a picture of the Exodus generation of the Israelites. And he's saying that's what the Christian life looks like, right? This time on earth is our wilderness, right? We are headed to our promised land. And what is he calling us to do? He's calling us to continue to trust in Jesus. And it's almost as if he's saying, you know what? Your trials are like their trials, and how we respond to our trials will determine whether or not we enter God's salvation rest. Right? Are we going to respond to trials in unbelief, or are we going to respond to trials in faith? So here's the question. How are we going to respond today? How are we going to respond today? We've heard the good news. Rest is available. Rest is available for every single person in this room. How will you respond? Now, let me say, there's a warning given to us in this passage. Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. What we need to understand is the longer you sit under the gospel, the more you hear the gospel and you don't respond to it, your heart starts to harden and harden and harden. That's why the sense of urgency. Today, if you hear his voice, today, if you hear the call to enter my rest, like respond. Like today, if you keep putting it off, if you keep putting off, that day may never come. And you may fall short. Like those first, those Exodus generation Israelites and never enter God's rest. And I think of 2 Corinthians 6:2, and I'm going to close with this. Paul says, in a favorable time, I listened to you. And in a day of salvation, I have helped you. In light of that, this is what Paul says. Behold, now is the favorable time. Behold, now is the day of salvation. Guys, do you get that? Today is the day. And I don't care. Listen, if you have never placed your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, right? Maybe you know about him. Maybe you can, right? You grew up in Sunday school. Maybe you even grew up in the church, but you've never trusted him. Hear his call today to trust him, to come to him in faith. Don't put it off. Like, respond today. Today is the day of salvation. Again, fear lest you shall enter his rest. And now, the other challenge is for those of us who have been following Christ, right? We're the church, right? We've placed our faith and trust in Jesus Christ. We are called to persevere in our faith, right? We're called to keep trusting, right? Not just trust Jesus, the salvation. Trust him today. Trust him tomorrow. Trust him the next day. Whatever you're going through, trust him in that. Trust him in your relationships. Trust him in your job. Trust him for provision. Like, trust him. That's what he calls us to do. And if you're not trusting him right now, how do we need to respond? We need to repent. Say, forgive us for not trusting you and help us to walk by faith. Help us to trust you. And listen, I know trusting Jesus sometimes feels like you're jumping off of a cliff. It does. Like, it's like, man, I don't know how this is going to go, but here I go. But that's what faith is all about. So listen, don't try to do what makes sense. Don't try to do what you can do in your own strength. Like, trust in Jesus. Trust him. He is worthy. He has proven that he can be trusted. And again, there is no reason that anybody in this room does not have this soul rest that Hebrews 4 is talking about. If you walk out of here without this soul rest, it's because you have acted or you have responded in unbelief. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your love. Thank you for Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord, that he came and he lived the life that we could not live. He died the death that we deserved. He stood in our place on the cross. He absorbed your wrath. He took our punishment, which is death. And then he rose again, conquering sin, conquering death, conquering hell, trailblazing the way for our salvation, that if we trust in him, that we too will die and be raised again. God, I think of Galatians 2:20. May that be our testimony today, for we have been crucified with Christ, and we no longer live, but Christ lives in us. And the life we now live, we live by faith in the Son of God who loved us and gave himself for us. God, I pray that every heart in this room would trust you for rest, for this salvation rest, for this soul rest. And God, I pray that you would help us to keep trusting and to keep trusting and to keep resting and to keep resting no matter what's going on around us. And God, help us to rest in you. And we ask all this in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
My fears relieved.
You guys can go ahead and have a seat. We're going to end our service by introducing those who are going to get baptized. So we're going to introduce them. They're going to get an opportunity to kind of share how God's been working in their lives. And then we're going to go exit outside after we close the service and we're going to dunk them. So that's how that's going to go down. So if you're getting baptized, I'm going to invite you to come up. And as they're coming up, I just want to just reinforce what we believe about baptism, right? So baptism, we again, in our Great Commission that we say every week, we say that we are to go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations by baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So what we believe, what Scripture teaches, is that baptism is not what saves us, right? We're not saved by works. We're saved by grace through faith. So they've placed their faith and trust in Jesus Christ. They are resting in God's finished work, and now they're getting baptized to say, to publicly declare what has taken place inwardly. So this is just a public profession of their faith in Christ, and I can't wait to hear from them, but this exactly, this what we talked about today is what they're doing. They are resting in the finished work of Christ for their salvation. They are no longer trusting in themselves. They're no longer trusting in being a good person. They're saying, hey, I am a sinner. And I am in need of a Savior, and praise God that there is a Savior that we can rest in. Amen? So who's first up? All right, JR, go ahead.
Thanks. All right. I'm not making fun of Drew. I got the cold, so this voice is not my normal one. But still bad. That's why they don't give me the mic in the morning. So I got a challenge and a little encouragement for you guys. The challenge is I'm going to say good morning, Lifehouse Smyrna. You're going to shout good morning to Jesus, all right? Good morning, Lifehouse Smyrna.
Good morning, Jesus.
Yeah, that was pretty good. Hey, so now we're going to pass the mic around. We're going to have a worship team tryouts. I know what you're thinking. Somebody's body snatched JR because I'm the quiet guy over here in the corner. And that's true. I don't talk much. Once I do, it's hard to get me to stop, though. So you see all the notes I got here. But thank you guys for coming, for gathering here, worshiping the Lord, and joining each of us in our next step of faith. It's a wonderful thing. Get a few things out of the way. My real name obviously isn't JR. Everybody knows me that because that's the way Cage knew me from the band. My real name's James W. Smith. I asked John a couple weeks ago if they baptized me with the wrong name, does that give me an out? He said no. So I'll go ahead and let that come forward. There's so much I wanted to say, but I typed it out because I obviously can't say everything. So I'm just here to tell you a little bit about myself. My wife and I this July will celebrate our 40th anniversary. Thank you. She, 5 years ago, had to go into a nursing home. She got early dementia, so we're apart, unfortunately, but we're still married, and look forward to being with her every day in eternity. So that's out of the way. So I grew up kind of I was a happy kid. My father was an executive with Medical Society. I had a good childhood, lived in a nice home in a community, pretty stable. We only moved once, and that was before I was in kindergarten, and we were the first family to move into the neighborhood, so all the kids that came afterwards, you know, I had plenty of friends, had good school that was close, so was able to play a lot of sports and stuff. None of it organized, but so I had that. My dad was kind of a fitness nut, so we had a weight set and a speed bag in the garage. So I grew up kind of being sporty. Then my mom went back to school, and I used to go with her. One of her requirements was to go to all the faculty music concerts and the student stuff. So I got exposed to a lot of classical music growing up. That all came to an end when I was 13. My dad decided to leave the family and run off with a woman from church and move west. So I went from being the youngest of three to single mom and just me. So my life just drastically changed, and I closed up, honestly. But I met a good friend who is still my best friend, very musical as well, and we got together through that. I went through a lot of years of drifting around, living in sin. All you kids, I can tell you, substance abuse does not have a future, so stay away from it. But thank God he saw me through all that. And how I met Christ, boy, that's a wonderful story. Got invited by a guy that I played golf with one day. I didn't know him, haven't seen him since, honestly. But he invited me to church, and three months later, I decided to go. And I got to church, and there's a drum kit, there's a guitar. He played trombone. I'm like, this isn't church. I grew up in church with a pipe organ and a choir, and it made me really nervous. And I sat in the back row as close to the door as I could so I could skedaddle out of there. And 11 o'clock on December the 7th, 2003, the Holy Spirit just came down on me. I felt a building fall on me that day. I couldn't walk out of that church. I was crying. And fortunately, they set me aside, and I was able to pray with them, and the Lord found me that day, and it's been a great life ever since. So he's seen me through some rough times, obviously. He told me, I heard his voice in 2013 say, there's something big coming. You need to be ready for, but I'm here with you. And that's with my wife. And he walked me through that. So I just want to say and thank you for all these guys that are getting baptized with me today. I love it. So I want to encourage you, if you've been praying for your plus one, you've been praying for somebody, you haven't seen the results, don't give up. I was 44 when I got saved. So there, it's never too late. And if you're in here and you're searching and you haven't found him yet, don't give up. There's nothing better than being one with the Lord. And I'm glad to have these guys here to walk me through, because I'm a child of the faith still. So thank you for your strength.
So if you guys ever want to check out the band, JR, he's pretty cool. They have a band called Raymond Lehman Band, and they just do a lot of awesome stuff. So you can follow them. And his stage name is JR Jones. His real name's JR Smith, though. So anyway, man, also today, just, man, thanks, JR, for sharing God's faithfulness of how he's saved and has been working in your life. Ron, you want to come forward? I'll just... sometimes it's hard speaking in a microphone, so I want to speak for everyone else. We've talked about testimonies and all that stuff. So this is Ron Hurt. And if you know Ron Hurt, his wife, Tanya, has been here for a little while now. And really, one of the big parts of Ron's story was the first time really coming here was about a year or so ago when Tanya took the step of faithfulness to be baptized after being saved. And Ron didn't really want to have anything to do with us. But soon afterwards, he started to come around, started hanging out. Him and Tom Vernersky actually eventually started working together in the workshop last May. So let me pause right here real quick. So a big part of Ron's story was watching his wife being faithful and saying, man, something's different, right? That's amazing. So as we take these steps of obedience, our families, our friends, people are watching and saying, what is this? But also, last May, Ron, I, Cage, and a couple other guys, we got to go on a hike. Cage told you the whole story, but there's more to that story. Part of that story was Ron was, man, we had a great time just hiking through the mountains and all that stuff. And part of it just had opportunities to share testimonies and share about the gospel. And Ron was even just told me just recently, he was like, man, if there was water right there, I would have got baptized right then. But since that time, Ron's been pursuing the Lord, listening, trying to figure out, hey, what does this all mean? And a few months ago, him and Cage, they walked through the Bible study, Christianity Explored. And through that, it just was clear, it's obvious. But man, Ron has come to know the Lord, and he's excited to take the step of obedience and following Jesus. So we're excited for you, Ron. Carmen. So if you guys know anything about Carmen, he's obviously newer to our church, but man, he has just jumped right in with everything. Him and Tara got married. When did you guys, was it past summer? October. Okay. So since that time, congratulations. But The basic story with Carmen was, man, he was not living for the Lord, and God has turned his heart towards the Lord, and he has been saved now for some time. And through this time, he's just ready to take the step of obedience, of baptism. So we're excited for you, Carmen, and just praying for you, brother. All right. Jackson, come here, man. So just so you guys know, we have a good population of redheads in this church. And he's not my son, in case you're wondering. But man, Jackson, it is cool to be part of a church and see the family of God continue to grow. 5 years ago, his dad, Jim, came into this church, and man, Jim was on fire, and he's been on fire ever since to follow and seek the Lord. And through that time, he's been faithful to weekly to share the gospel with his son, to also talk to him and just encourage him in the faith. And I know Jim's been praying for this, and Corey, too, now has been praying just for God to move in a mighty way. And this past week, past couple weeks, actually, Jackson and I, we sat down, we were just talking. He shared, you know, about, hey, believing in God. Like, he actually, you know, because there was a point where Jackson would not take communion because he knew he didn't believe it. So he's like, well, I'm not going to do that then. And, you know, him and his father had those conversations. But then there came this turning point in the past few weeks where we were, doing and just so you know, Jackson might not act like he's listening, but he's taking note of everything you're saying. Like when we went to the winter retreat, man, he was just asking some of the best questions and sharing some of the best things about what he was learning. But a few weeks ago, we were studying student ministry here on Wednesday nights, and we were of all stories God used to really just bring Jackson to the Lord was a story of David and Bathsheba. And the reason that was in that part of that story is a great repentance of David. And Jackson just said his heart just felt like he was opened up when he heard that this king, a king of all people, had to bow down and submit to God as Lord. And he said he wanted to do the same thing. And so, Jackson, we're proud of you. We're praying for you, brother, and just excited as you begin this journey of following Jesus, man. So. All right. So, y'all, this is Grace Walker. She actually wrote up her testimony for us to share today. I want to read it. Man, I think I was a little bit in tears when I was reading it the first time because of God's grace is so good and so sufficient. So let me just read this to y'all. Grace said, before I became a Christian, I was in the dark. I wasn't thinking about what God could do for me, and I didn't know what I was living for. I was always worried about what would happen next, or would be singing a song at church, and I didn't know what it meant. I've been there. I knew a big part of my life was missing, and when the church started doing a daily Bible reading, I had the urge to start doing it with my family. And after reading for about a month, I got frustrated. And I couldn't understand what it meant. And I started to drift away from God and the Bible. When I started going to the morning kids, Lifehouse Kids program in church, I realized that I really needed God to rule over my life and let him take control. I started to get into devotions, and he encouraged me to get to know him more. And that's how I learned that he was in control of my life. Once I started to go to LSM, our youth group, I loved discussing my trust and other things about God with others. And when I went to the reboot camp, we just went to last month, it helped me realize that God is my light and I need to share the gospel with others who may not know him. When I began reading the Bible to another person at school, I started to know that they really weren't interested in knowing him just like I was. The fact that she was still in the dark and didn't know she was sinful helped me know that she really needed the Savior. I started confessing my sins to God and started to understand why Jesus died on the cross for me. I trusted God more and more each day. And praying, getting into the Bible, making time for him helped me know that I needed to let him use me in my life for his work so that his plan succeeds and shows the world who he is. And that's when I realized I wanted to be a Christian, accepting my life and letting him use me. So we're excited for you, Grace. Just want to, we are so excited for each and every one of you and the story of God's grace in your life. It is amazing to watch God work. I want to go over some details real quick. We're going to have it's 11, almost 11:40, so 11:50, we're going to start the baptism outside in the third bay. We're going to pull up the door. We're at a baptism at the door. Just some other things that would be helpful. There's a lot of people, which is awesome. If you're in the front, just try to kneel down if you can. Or for kids, just try to kneel them or sit them down somewhat way. That just helps so everybody can see God's work in here through this time and this time as we profess our faith in Jesus Christ. So at 11:40, the other thing too is if you have kids in Lifehouse Kids Junior, they're ready to they're ready for you. So after the service, make sure you pick them up, pick up your babies and all that. And then the final thing as I kind of bring this all to a close here is we will also have a Lifehouse Kids training after the baptism. So once the baptism's over, within 5 minutes, they'll start the training. If you serve in Lifehouse Kids ministry, Lifehouse Littles from birth to fifth grade, and we want you to be part of this training. We're doing some crucial things for you, and we need you there. So let me pray, and then we'll do our stand-up, and we'll do our commission, and then we'll start the baptism at 11:50. So let's pray. Father, just thank you again for your grace and your mercy, Lord. You are so faithful. God, I thank you that you hear our prayers and that you desire and you have not only desire, but you made a way for us to come to know you, Jesus Christ. Thank you that you draw us nearer to us. Lord, I pray right now if there's anyone in this room that you're stirring in the hearts, Lord, that maybe they not say that they believe in you now, Lord, that they would come and let us know. God, today is the day of salvation. I pray they would cry out to you, repent of their sins, and believe in Jesus Christ. And if they're saved, Lord, I pray that they would take a step of obedience to be baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Father, we thank you for your grace again. And man, use these testimonies for the glory of your name and to reach more people with the gospel. In your holy name we pray. Amen. All right, church, let's stand up and we'll say our commission. All right. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. Let's live sent in Lifehouse Smyrna. Mm-hmm.